Well, Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. It's another good day. Every day when you have a day to live is good. So I am I'm grateful to be here. I'm grateful that the Almighty has assigned me, my family, and the people who are watching and joining us here to be here. We are the remnant. We are the few. We are the chosen. And as we continue down this path, we get to understand that according to Yeshua, we actually truly see that few find this road. And that's not necessarily something to be worried or concerned. Well, to some degree, we can be concerned about that. But the reality is we're in a privileged position. We can look at the king or the queen and the royal family and look upon them, and we can speak about the privileges that they are entitled to because they are royal. But the reality is Father is raising up a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, a kingdom of priests. And it just so happens that we are very peculiar people. We're just peculiar people amongst other people. So even this week, a lady at work pointing to my seat and wanted to know what it was. And I told her what it was, and she was telling me, I knew there was something about you. I knew that you there was something special about you, and that she was Catholic. And she wanted to know if I was a priest, if I was a priest or something like that, because there was something. So we are different. We are peculiar, and sometimes we can find ourselves in positions where we stand out. But that's not a bad thing. That's a good thing. I believe, as we will see in the scriptures, that the world is crying out for something. The Bible teaches us that even creation groans for the children of God to manifest themselves, to reveal themselves. And we're seeing a time right now where there is certainly iniquity abounding. People are looking to the left, to the right, all around, philosophy, politics, all kinds of religious movements to get some light and some peace in their homes, going from assembly to assembly to try and find that place. But you'll find rest in Yeshua. You will find rest in Yeshua, and that's what we're trying to minister and teach Yeshua's disciples, to teach, demonstrate, and heal the people. So let's begin. So again, we welcome everyone, and we ask everyone to join us. If you have a heart for the word, for discipleship, for the truth, then come and join us. This is what we do. This is what we teach. So you won't necessarily find that we toe the line of any religious denomination. So we won't be necessarily reading prayers or reading this, that, and the other, or saying things which are not attributed in the word, because we're part of our vision is to be true worshippers as defined in the Bible. I ask that everyone supports our social media outreach, and all that requires is, it doesn't require a day or a two-day workshop. You just press send. And I know that many of us were spending a lot of time on social media. So all you really need to do is press the buttons which get our ministry over to as many people as possible. So if you're on Twitter, you can retweet. If you're on Facebook, you can share. If you're on YouTube, you can share, like and comment, and so on and so forth. And that will just help us get the good news further along the way. Just so everyone knows, if you didn't know, we have a new website. And this new website is as far as I'm concerned and from what I'm hearing from the people, is a lot better in terms of usage than the previous one. I've not gone on this website and found that the shop or pages are missing. It's working, so that makes it better. So I encourage everyone to go to our website, www.hoilondon.co.uk or .com. Whatever you choose will get you to this place, and check it out. Check out our blog, which we've recently started doing. We did our first blog this week. Check out our about page, which includes the service time. It includes information about what we believe, what our vision is, and our vision of the future, how corporate and businesses can support us in terms of reaching our vision of the future. So go on, check out, support our website, and I'm sure you'll find it's another step in the right direction for us. At the end of the teaching, you will have an opportunity to ask questions. Today, I believe we're going to see some stuff, we're going to talk about some stuff regarding the Holy Spirit, which maybe you've not really considered before, you might not have seen before. I believe this has been a revelation to me, so I'm sure it might be a revelation to some of you all. So do ask questions. If I can't answer the question because it's not in the word, the answer, then that's all I'm going to say. I'm just going to not go beyond what's written. That includes anyone who is online watching us live on Facebook or on YouTube. You can also make comments, testify, ask for prayer, and you can also support us with your tithes and offerings. I'd also just remind everyone who is here today is that there is a box which says gift aid on our envelopes. And if you just simply tick that box, whatever you donate to the ministry, the government will add another 25% to your donation. Just that little tick. It doesn't require anything else from you. The ministry will go and deal with the government and sort that kind of stuff out. So it's just a simple thing which just adds more value to what you are giving. So please do, if you do support us, tick that box. Our vision is to be a worshipping people, an evangelistic community, a discipleship center, an equipping network, and a worldwide witness for Yeshua the Messiah. And in accordance to that vision, we've set out what we want for the future, and that's on our website. But also we've established and we've agreed that at least once a month, on the last Shabbat of the month, we're going to gather as a fellowship at the end of our breaking bread and fellowship, and we're going to just spend some time in prayer. And we did that, we began that last week, even though that wasn't the last Shabbat of the month. But going forward, I'm letting you know now, so if you desire to join us, to be in prayer for us and with us, then you can earmark just a little bit of extra time. It's just going to be an additional hour for you to stay and pray with us. Typically, what we're praying for would be the house of Israel as a collective, not just in London or in Charlotte or in Ukraine or in Russia, but the household of Israel. Praying for the ministry, praying for my family, your family, praying for the pouring out of Father's Spirit upon all flesh to begin, and to begin where we are, for him to raise up more people, and so on and so forth. So every Sabbath from now on, every last Sabbath of the month, we'll be spending time as a community, as a fellowship in prayer. So Yeshua's disciple today, the Holy Spirit. Let's begin in some prayer. Father in heaven, we are thankful to be alive today. We know that as long as you permit. We're here on this earth and we're here to serve you and keep your commandments and fear you. So as a result, we have come here today, setting this day aside to be in the place and time that you have designated us to be. We ask, Father, that as we are here gathered in the name of Yeshua, that you are welcomed and your presence is ushered into this place. Today we will be speaking on and teaching on and discussing the Holy Spirit in accordance to your word. Some of us may have an understanding of what the Holy Spirit is more than others. But I'm praying, whatever the case may be, that you will reveal yourself to us today. That you will give us eyes to see and ears to hear. For it is written that those who have eyes to see and ears to hear, that you will heal them. It's those who don't have eyes to see and ears to hear, who don't get healed by you. So we ask that you open up our understanding, that there be revelation today, that the manifestation of the Spirit, words of wisdom, knowledge, and prophecy, and an increasing of faith manifest here today. Father, I ask that you use me to speak your word, and you use your people to speak your word to me. We have set this day aside to be in your presence. And in your presence, Father, it lets us know that there is the fullness of joy. So we ask that heaviness, anxiety, fear, depression amongst us, amongst your people here and those online, flee from the midst of us. We don't want to be under any yoke of bondage apart from that easy burden of Yeshua. We desire to be free. We no longer want to be captive in Babylon or in Egypt, but free to walk in the power and authority, in obedience to your commandments and to your word, following the footsteps of Yeshua day by day. May your word today be a light unto our feet, guiding us and leading us to the next stage of our walk with you. In Yeshua's name we pray that you have your way. Amen. Amen. So, let's begin. And again, I would encourage everyone to spend some time, if you so desire, to at the beginning of Yeshua's disciple. Every teaching that we're doing is moving in a direction which is building upon each other. So even though this will make sense on its own, I do ask that you watch the previous teaching. So prior to his crucifixion, Yeshua taught his disciples that his blood was the blood of the new covenant. And we established that in the previous teaching called the New Testament. Yeshua's disciple, the New Testament. Shed for the remission of sins for many. He therefore identified himself as the mediating blood sacrifice, bringing the two parties, YeHoVaH and the disciples of Yeshua, who is Israel, into an everlasting agreement, the new covenant. That you could call is a summary of the entire teaching that we did previously. And this is what he says and where we can pull that thread to get to where we are today. In Matthew 26, 28. For this is my blood of the New Testament. And that New Testament is talking about the New Covenant, which is dē-ä-thā, which is a covenant, a testament, agreement to cut or divide. And when we looked a bit further, what we were able to see is that this cut or dividing, this New Testament is really dealing with a memorial sacrifice. And what we were able to do is to go all the way back when we're looking at covenants and testaments, all the way back to Abraham. So, this new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins, he's asking his disciples to do some things, to eat bread, to drink wine in remembrance of him. And then he's describing what the bread and what the wine means in that remembrance of him. However, it was after his resurrection, once the blood of the new covenant was shed, that Yeshua bestowed his disciples with a gift, which would empower them to share the good news of the new covenant through his blood to the world. Now, I would like you to go to John chapter 20. I'm not sure, I don't think I've heard a teaching which includes this. So maybe down the road, there might be a teaching on this alone, because I've not heard one so far. But we're just going, because we're dealing with Yeshua's disciples, we're going to touch on it and keep it moving. John chapter 20, verse 19. Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, when the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and saith unto them, peace be unto you. What we're seeing in the Bible is there's a situation where Yeshua has been crucified on the fourth day of the week. He's placed in the sepulchre, and now it's the seventh day. And what a lot of this stuff, just in summary, we deal with in detail in the book, The Mark of the Church, The Sign of God. There's a diagram. There's some key points. There's all of the scriptures which take you through. So as most of you here and online, I presume you would have heard that teaching. So I'm giving myself permission to sort of breeze through this. So his disciples are in the room. They're in the place on the first day of the week, as it says here. And when he had so said, he showed unto them his hands and his side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. Then Jesus said unto them again, peace be unto you. As my Father have sent me, even so send I you into the world. So when we are looking at the Great Commission, we might go to certain passages in the Bible. Typically, people go to Matthew 28 for the Great Commission, or they might go to a certain passage in Mark. And when we looked at the Great Commission, it didn't necessarily include John in that first teaching. But this is a commission from Yeshua regarding his disciples. He's saying to them, as Father has sent me, so I send you into the world. When we look at other passages, what we're seeing here is that the disciples of Yeshua have the ministry, like Yeshua, of reconciliation. We have his ministry. So when we come to passages where it talks about greater things can his disciples do than him because they believe in him, then that greater works really includes us if we choose to believe it. And in verse 22, and when he had said this, He breathed. Emphuseno, and that's to blow or breathe upon. 17:20 in the Greek. He breathed on them and saith unto them, receive you the Holy Ghost. And that's pneuma, which is 41:51, the Spirit. So when we're looking at this Holy Ghost, I'm probably going to be saying Spirit. A movement of air. So now, and here is the revelation. That on the first day of the week, Yeshua breathed upon his disciples and told them to receive the Holy Spirit. We know from looking and going through scripture that Yeshua rose according to the scriptures on the weekly Sabbath. We know that when it comes down to Passover, unleavened bread, according to the scriptures, the day of first fruits is the day following the weekly Sabbath. Yeshua, according to scripture, is the first fruits of among the dead. To the degree that he was the one who rose and ascended to the Father on the day of first fruits. We know this because he said to Mary not to touch him because he hasn't ascended yet. Now, when the rest of the women came, they was worshipping, touching his feet. And that was a later occurrence. So he descended and come back. But on this same day, Yeshua breathes on his disciples and they receive, or they're instructed to receive, the Holy Spirit on the day of first fruits. Now, we know that there was certain people in that room and there were certain people who were not in the room. Thomas wasn't in the room. Judas wasn't in the room because he'd fallen away. But when you study who was in the room, it's not the same people who were in the other room in Acts 2. And here's some scripture to sort of solidify the day of first fruits, Yeshua being the first fruits, and we even go as far as to see that the disciples are first fruits. So Leviticus 23:10, speak unto the children of Israel and say unto them, when you come into the land which I give unto you and shall reap the harvest thereof, then ye shall bring a sheaf of the first fruits of your harvest unto the priest. And he shall wave the sheaf before Jehovah to be accepted for you. On the morrow after the Sabbath, the priest shall wave it. 1 Corinthians 15:20. But now is Messiah risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. We can see Yeshua as the first fruits of those that slept of among the dead. But here are some disciples who were receiving the Spirit on the day of first fruits. So after 3 days and three nights in the sepulchre, Yeshua rose on the weekly Sabbath. Again, that's something we clearly establish in the mark of the church and sign of God. So watch the teaching, or the book is available for anyone. However, on the day of first fruits, the very next day, the day Yeshua ascended to the Father, being the first fruits from among the dead, Yeshua commissions, sends his disciples as he was sent, and gives them the Holy Spirit. He breathes on them and tells them to receive the Holy Spirit, making them the first fruits of the Spirit, filled with a new breath of life. Romans chapter 8. Verse 10. And if Messiah be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the spirit is life because of righteousness. But if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his spirit that dwelleth in you. So what we're seeing the Paul tell the congregation at Rome is that essentially, if you are filled with the Spirit, which the Bible teaches Messiah imparts and gives and baptizes his disciples with, then the same Holy Spirit which rose up Yeshua from the dead on the day appointed will raise you up. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live after the flesh. For if we live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself bearing witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. For I reckon that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willing, but by reason of him whom have subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole of creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit. Even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to it the redemption of our body. The Bible teaches that there is a day when Father is going to pour out his Spirit on all flesh. On all flesh. And this is something which Peter talks about in Acts chapter 2 when he's explaining what's going on there. So we have a situation where Father's Spirit, the Holy Spirit, will be poured out upon all flesh. But then there is a pouring out of the Spirit of YeHoVaH upon the disciples of Yeshua. These are considered the first fruits. So we have a situation where you have a first fruits of first fruits, when an exclusive, limited number of people are breathed upon and told to receive the Spirit on the day of first fruits. So, the same Spirit that rose Yeshua from the dead, the Holy Spirit, Yeshua breathed on his disciples. The flesh is bound because of the sin of Adam to see corruption, but the Spirit that is holy brings life because it's everlasting. We can go all the way to the beginning of the book. All the way to the beginning of the book. We know that although man was made in the image and likeness of Elohim, Elohim, God, YeHoVaH, is not a man. He is spirit. So when he's doing this breathing into the Adam, into this thing which was made from the dust of the earth, he became a living soul. The Holy Spirit is directly connected to life. Life here in this present time and life forevermore. It's only when we try to mix the breath of Elohim, the Holy Spirit, with the flesh man, with the corrupt part of man, that we come to a place like Adam where we surely perish. So again, and when he had said this, he breathed. Emphuseo, and that's the 1720 in the Greek, and that's to breathe, to blow upon. Now I'm just going to read a short quote. The Greek word here used to is employed nowhere else in the New Testament. So it's not used anywhere else in the New Testament, but is the very one used in the Septuagint translators of Genesis 2, verse 7. So when we're looking at the Septuagint, which is the Greek version of the Hebrew Bible, the Tanakh, you do not find in the New Testament this word any other place, 1720, but you do find this word all the way in Genesis. Genesis chapter 2, verse 7. And YeHoVaH Elohim formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed. And this is Nafach. 5301, to breathe, to blow, sniff at, sieve, give up or loose life into the nostrils and the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Their man's original creation was completed by this very act of God. Who then can fail to see, and this again, this is a quote, that here in John 20, on the day of the Savior's resurrection, and we've established that he rose on the weekly Sabbath, not on the first day of the week, so I'm stressing that this is a quote. The new creation had begun by the head of the new creation, the last Adam, acting as a quickening spirit. And when we look at the Greek, and we will look at the Greek in terms of quickening spirit, the quickening spirit is talking about giving life. And we'll see that in the Greek. And this is Arthur W. Pink, Exposition of the Gospel of John, page 1100, a very large book. So the spirit that breathed life into Adam, making him a living soul, Yeshua breathed, gave to his disciples. The spirit that rose Yeshua from the grave, he gives to his disciples, who mortifies their flesh so they can live by the spirit. And here it is, John 6, verse 63. It is the Spirit that quickeneth. And this word quickeneth is zoopio. I'm not even going to try it. It's 2227. Anyone who can get this right, yeah. Zoopioeo. Zoopioeo, something along those lines. To produce life, beget or bear, living young, to cause to live, make alive, give life. So Yeshua is saying during his ministry that it is the Spirit that gives life, that quickeneth. It's the Spirit that makes one be alive. The flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit, and they are life. So now, when we're looking at the ministry of Yeshua, he's saying to his disciples, the words that I'm speaking to you, they are spirit, they are life. Yes. So if you are listening and obeying and hearkening unto my words, then you shall receive life. Hallelujah. Now his disciples are learners of him. They're people who believe the words or should believe what he is saying. So as a consequence, if you are obedient to his words, you believe in his words, you believe in him who is the word, then you shall receive life everlasting. And he shares that with his disciples. And we see that in John chapter 20. Galatians 6 verse 7. Be not deceived, God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, he shall also reap. For he that soweth to the flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. So there's this process now where the disciples of Yeshua need to be more concerned about things of the Spirit than they are about the flesh. Because you can sow into your flesh, and if you sow into your flesh, it profits you nothing. But if you sow into your spirit, then you inherit, you reap life everlasting. And this is what Yeshua came to give to the people. The Father doesn't want any to perish. So he sent his word, which is spirit, which is life, to speak to the people, to show the people how they can acquire life, how they can walk and live and receive things of the spirit. So whoever believes in him can have the promise, which he promised to his disciples. So Yeshua is the word made flesh. His word come from YeHoVaH, who is spirit. When Yeshua speaks, his words are spirit and life because they come from the one who gives life and is spirit. Yeshua breathing to impart the spirit to his disciples is him fulfilling his promise to them regarding eternal life to those who believe in him. So at the appointed time, the spirit that rose Yeshua, being in him, shall raise his disciples. We can look at the ministry of Peter, of John, of Paul, of Yeshua, and we can place them in the book, not realizing that just because that book is finished, that there isn't any other books which are still being written. Father is opening books to determine the works of the people that include all of us in it. So we have a book, the Word of YeHoVaH, which is in that book, the Bible. But Father says the books are going to be opened and we are in that book. So we need to connect ourselves with what is said in the book and not exclude ourselves from being part of the book, if that makes sense. So at creation, YeHoVaH breathed into Adam and he became a living soul. After his resurrection, sealing the new covenant in his blood, on the day of first fruits, Yeshua breathed on his disciples, fulfilling his promise to them regarding everlasting life, as written in the prophets. And we see this spoken about in the prophets. Ezekiel 37, if you can turn there in your Bible, please. Ezekiel 37. Give him a tap. Verse 9. Then said he unto them, prophesy unto the wind. a situation where Ezekiel is looking upon this valley of dry bones. Father is saying to Ezekiel, you prophesy unto the wind. Prophesy, son of man, and say unto the wind, thus saith the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe. Nafach, 5301, to breathe, to blow, sniff, sieve. It's the same word that we find in Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, which in the Septuagint is the same word we see in John chapter 20. So, to breathe upon these slain that they may live. So, we're seeing the connection not only in the New Testament with the breath of life, we're seeing it not only in the Torah, but now we're seeing it in the prophets. And this is speaking about, in the prophets, a time that shall come. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived, and stood up upon their feet, an exceeding great army. Then he said unto them, son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Behold, they say, our bones are dried, and our hope is lost. We are cut off for our parts. Therefore prophesy and say unto them, thus saith the Lord God, behold, O my people, I will open your graves and cause you to come out of your graves and bring you into the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am YeHoVaH when I have opened your graves, O my people, and brought you up out of your graves, and shall put my spirit in you, and ye shall live. The spirit, the breathing of the spirit, the instruction to receive the spirit through the breathing is connected with life. We're going to see that when Yeshua says something to Nicodemus, that you won't see the kingdom, you won't enter the kingdom until you're born again. Nicodemus has no clue about this born again process. What does it mean? How are you to be born again? And we'll carry on and we'll cover that in a moment. And I shall put my spirit in you, and you shall live. And I will place you in your own land. Then shall you know that I, YeHoVaH, have spoken it and performed it, saith the Lord. So the spirit that YeHoVaH promised to give to the household of Israel that they might live, Yeshua was sent to baptize his followers in. This is what he was sent to baptize his followers in John chapter 1. This is John the Baptist, the greatest of all prophets born among women, according to Yeshua. The next day, John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. This is going back to what he would do as being the atoning sacrifice, the mediator between man and YeHoVaH in terms of the new covenant for the remission of sins. This is he of whom I said, after me cometh a man which is preferred before me, for he was before me. And I knew him not, but that he should live, that he should be made manifest to Israel. Therefore am I come baptizing with water. And John bare record, saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him. And I knew him not. But he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining, the same is he which baptizeth with the Holy Spirit. So this whole situation where we see the Spirit descending on Yeshua like a dove, was confirmation to John that Yeshua was the one who would come and baptize his disciples with the Spirit. Now John, although this is being spoken to John, we can clearly see evidence in Scripture where this baptism, this giving of the Spirit, is also written. John didn't just make this stuff up. Yeshua just didn't come on the scene and start talking this crazy stuff and create a new religion. We don't have a new religion being created when we get to Jesus. Yeshua told the people that he's come to fulfill what was written. So when he's talking about the Spirit for his disciples, he's fulfilling what is written. And we see that when we look at that passage in Ezekiel. Without faith in Yeshua, believing in him as the Son of YeHoVaH, the Messiah, the Prophet, the King of Israel, the Lamb of God, for our atoning sacrifice, because he is the one that sends the Spirit to his disciples, that Spirit which gives everlasting life, it's impossible to enter into life. So, it's a challenge. There are situations where we can get attached to people, where we can call people brother and sister and believe that we can be part of a fellowship when the fellowship of people that you're a part of doesn't necessarily believe in Yeshua. But if you are someone who is filled with the Spirit and is born again, you necessarily cannot be brothers with someone who isn't related to you. It doesn't necessarily make sense. If you're born again and your father is your father in heaven, how is there this fellowship and brethren and this kind of thing with people who don't believe in Yeshua, who is the means as to being born again? Yeshua said it himself, that my mother and my brethren are those that do the will of my Father in heaven. So now, for us to have brethren which don't believe in Yeshua, we have to once again circumnavigate the teachings of Yeshua and create our own doctrine, which includes different groups of people. This is the kind of thing that Oprah Winfrey wants to tell the people, that there's many ways. And when you pin them down, this is what the kind of thing that the church leaders that you get on CNN and TBN and ABC when they're being interviewed. Because they're afraid of the people. They're afraid of losing their resources. So everyone can get there. Everyone can enter the kingdom. There's many paths, this, that, and the other. That's not what Yeshua taught. So John chapter 4, verse 10. In John chapter 4, verse 10, Jesus answered and said unto her, and he's talking with the Samaritan woman, if thou knowest the gift of God, and when we pin this down, he's talking about the Holy Spirit. We know that the Holy Spirit is the gift. It's a gift. Not the manifestations are gifts. So we shouldn't get into the mindset that you have the gift of healing or you have this, that, or the other. If you've got the gift of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit in you can work the manifestations of it being in you. It's whether you are desiring to manifest that in your life. And I can say, and I'm sure everyone's got testimonies, but the moment I put it in my mind that I wanted Father to use me in terms of the word of knowledge, for example, that's when I prayed for it and I receive what I prayed for. If you don't believe in healing, you're not going to put your hands on someone and pray for them for healing. So it's the Holy Spirit that's the gift, not the manifestations. So if thou knowest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou would have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. The woman saith unto him, Sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, the well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? Yeshua is teaching this woman the word, and she can't recognize that he's teaching, speaking the word. Words are just coming out of his mouth. She thinks he's talking about water from the well, but he's actually talking about scripture. He's saying to the woman, and we're going to see that there is some scripture about this living water, that if you drink of this water, it's going to quench the thirst of thirsty people. It's going to be life unto you. This is what he's saying to the woman. Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well, and drank thereof himself, and his children, and his cattle? Jesus answered and said unto her, Whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. So we're talking about water springing up into everlasting life. There's this everlasting life which comes by the Spirit, which we're going to see. And then there's this flesh desire for water, which according to Yeshua profits nothing. You're just going to thirst again. But if I give you this water of the Spirit, it will spring, it will be into you, you'll never thirst again. John 7:37. In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood up and cried, saying, If any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scriptures have said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. And here's the explanation. But this spake he of the Spirit. This is why we can't take scriptures in isolation. You take scriptures in isolation, then you won't understand the explanation that John gives you in the next few chapters. But this spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive. For the Holy Spirit was not yet given, because that Jesus was not yet glorified. And here is one of those passages. There's a number of different passages, but this is one I've put in. Isaiah 44:3. For I will pour water upon him, that's Isaiah 44:3, that is thirsty, and floods upon the dry ground. I will pour my spirit upon thy seed, and my blessing upon thine offspring. So when Yeshua is talking to this Samaritan woman, he's essentially speaking, the scriptures are just flowing from his lips. The Samaritan woman recognizes that he's a prophet, a man of God, because of the manifestation of the Spirit, which is in him, words of knowledge. She goes and gets the Samaritan people, and they believe on him. He tells her he is the Messiah, and they believe. So it is deception to teach that anyone can acquire the Spirit of YeHoVaH, which leads to eternal life, whilst excluding Yeshua. It is a deception. Yeshua saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Those who believe in Yeshua receive from him the gift of the Holy Spirit, which Yeshua breathed onto his disciples as YeHoVaH breathed into Adam. This is new life. Yeshua gives to his disciples, allowing them to enter the kingdom, which flesh and blood cannot inherit. And this is, we can connect this with the teaching he gives to Nicodemus. In John chapter 3, Jesus answered in verse 3 and said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. So flesh and blood can't inherit it. But we are flesh and blood. But when you are filled with the Spirit, then you are also a spirit man. You're a spirit man anyway. But when you're filled with His Spirit, just like we see with the disciples, talking in Romans chapter 8, then you're in a place where though your flesh man may perish, you shall live. And if you live as Yeshua lived, then you will inherit as Yeshua inherited. So we're co-heirs with Yeshua. Amen. If we have the same father as Yeshua, then Yeshua is our brother. If Peter has the same father as Yeshua, who has the same father as me, then Peter is my brother. Nicodemus saith unto him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Yeshua answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of the water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom. He can't see the kingdom. He can't enter into the kingdom. Flesh and blood can't inherit this stuff. As disciples of Yeshua, it's therefore imperative that we be a people who are walking and seeking and desiring things of not just any spirit, because there are many spirits, but of the Holy Spirit. Those who are led by the Spirit of Elohim are the sons of Elohim. So it's not just a case about knowledge, because Nicodemus had some knowledge. He was a teacher of Israel. He had some knowledge. Just like Paul, a teacher in Israel, had some knowledge. But until Paul received revelation, when Paul received revelation, that's when he considered all of that knowledge to be dung, so he can move by the Spirit whilst believing what was written in the Psalms, in the prophets, in the Torah. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again. So, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. No man can enter the kingdom without born again via Yeshua. Yeshua, who is the word of YeHoVaH made flesh, his words are spirit and life. And when you have faith in him, you receive YeHoVaH's spirit and consequently eternal life. Sometimes we can get into the place where we start saying to ourselves, okay, because we've come from places that believe this kind of stuff, if I've got the Holy Spirit, then I must do this. Trying to put you in a box, to confine you, to be looking for one thing because you have the Spirit. When it comes down to the things of the Spirit, for example, on that instance, when he breathed his Spirit on his disciples, we don't see in that instance there being speaking in tongues. When we see Yeshua coming out of the water, we don't see him speaking in tongues. What we see in his ministry is healing, prophecy, words of wisdom, words of knowledge. We see faith, but we don't necessarily see speaking in tongues. What he says is that these are the signs of them that believe. They shall speak in new tongues. And what people tend, especially from a particular group of Christian background, they stick everything on the speaking of tongues, but don't ever look for anything else. And we can't be that kind of people, because the Holy Spirit is the gift. If you just focus on one area and that's your ministry, as we look in the book of Corinthians, what does this mean? How, as a people, are we going to know when to march, when to go to war, when to battle, if no one understands what the sound means of the horn or of the bell? If no one can interpret, because no one's praying for interpretation, then it really is what it looks like. Running up and down, rolling around. No one understands what is going on. First Peter 1:22. Seeing you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love of the brethren, see that you love one another with a pure heart fervently. What we can see just from that verse alone is that in order to do some purification of your soul, there needs to be some obedience to the truth. If you obey the truth, that's being done through the Spirit. People seem to think that you're either this or you're that. If you're this, you can't be that, because no. And we're going to look at that when we move further into the Spirit. If you want to purify your souls, if you want to go through this process of renewing your mind, there needs to be obedience to the truth. You need to put new thoughts in your mind. You need to have new words in your heart, which lead to your actions, which is why Yeshua said justification is a matter of what you say. What you say comes from within. But all of that stuff is through the Spirit. Unto unfeigned love of the brethren, see that you love one another with a pure heart fervently. Be born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. So this whole born-again process, which Yeshua initiates with his disciples, which we can connect with being a living soul in Genesis chapter 2, goes all the way back to the very beginning. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Yeshua is the Word made flesh. If you want to get to a place of how do I receive the Spirit? How do I become born again? How do I open up the doorways of my temple so I am a tabernacle for his presence? It all goes down to the Word. What does it say? How did they receive? Well, they received his Spirit because they followed the Spirit made flesh. They believed on him, and he gave them his Spirit. When he told them to stay in Jerusalem until you receive the promise, if you weren't in Jerusalem, you weren't going to receive the promise. That's one of the problems that I'm guessing Timothy had, because he wasn't there. He wasn't near to receive it in John chapter 20, after when they was in the room. For all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man as the flower of grass. The grass withereth, and the flower therefore falleth away. And Peter here, again, is quoting the prophets. He's quoting Isaiah here. But the word of YeHoVaH, the word of the Lord, endureth forever. And this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you. So heaven and earth shall pass, it will pass. But the word of the Almighty endureth forever. This is the gospel which was preached unto them by Yeshua, by the apostles and by the other disciples. We can't exclude Yeshua from the word and be believers in the word and be in expectation to receive what is in the word. Can't do it, no matter what people will say. So no man can acquire eternal life without Yeshua. Yeshua is the word of YeHoVaH. YeHoVaH is spirit. And the word of Yeshua is spirit and life. The words of YeHoVaH endure forever. And when you believe and receive his word, Yeshua, as his disciples, you shall endure forever. This promise, as found through the scriptures, is part of the new covenant. It's part and parcel of the new covenant. And we can see it right here in Acts 2:38. And we're finishing on this. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, the new covenant, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is unto you, and to your children, and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. Amen. Amen. So, again, I know when I was putting this teaching together, I saw some new things that I've not necessarily seen before. And this is a good opportunity for anyone who has some questions. And like what I said, I can't go beyond what is written. So if I can't answer your question because it's not written, if someone can find what's written, then that will be, that's all good. But if not, then I can just tell you, it's not written. So for the people here, before we look online, is there any questions, specifically questions about the teaching here today? No questions. I'm trying to get onto Facebook so I can see if there's any questions. Dee, can you have a look? Okay. Okay, I'm going to wait until this goes up. I'm just going to put it out there. Does anyone have any prayer requests or things that people want to pray about? Yeah. Yes. Yes, Sylvie, yeah.
Medication, and they have made mistakes, they have recognized that, oh, we didn't give you the right medication, and now we're calling up for another medication. And that person is a Christian, or define themselves as a Christian. And they've been just taking in all this stuff, and without going to God and say, what is your point of view on how I'm being treated here? And also, in terms of that person's diet, I could see the ignorance that is also within the body of Christ, where people indulge in excess of food, excess of sugar, and in the world where people are not, who do not identify as Christians, they are already aware of all this danger of eating nonsense. They are already aware of that. But in the body of Christ, even when they are gathering, prayer gathering, people are just eating things that are destroying them. And I'm just praying now today for the Holy Spirit to touch people's hearts, to be taught in this kind of thing that seems very simple, but we have lost track of getting God's point of view on how we manage our life, how we manage our diet, and what is going on in the medical system. So it's really for the Holy Spirit to bring an awakening within the body of Christ. That's my prayer.
And what's this individual's name?
His name is Martin, and they have just his brain stem is completely dead. So they're just waiting in a couple of minutes. They might say pronounce that person dead, and yes, it's really I don't want to focus on that person only. It's really, I'm crying out for the Holy Spirit to touch everyone who think they are really a Christian, to really tune in the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit has a lot of things to teach us. That's my
And we can connect the Spirit to the Word in that very same situation, because when you connect the Spirit to the Word, by the Spirit, people have a reference point to how to live their lives, what to define as things that you shouldn't touch, things that you shouldn't put in or on your body for an optimum health, for how to be holy, set apart, and how to live. And then once you have that understanding, you now have parameters to look at as to how to define things which are biblically clean, like, for example, chicken. It's biblically clean, but the stuff that is being put into the chicken isn't clean. So this biblically clean chicken, I need to not eat this chicken, because the stuff which is being pumped into is unclean, and I now need to go to another place or another range or another quality of chicken to get a clean chicken. And that comes essentially by the Spirit through revelation, but we can find that in the acceptance of the Word. Father prepared his people so they can live, and we see that. When you adhere and follow the Word, he gives you the means for you to live in it in forevermore. But whilst you are here, you are his vessel, and you can't share or be a good witness if you can't walk, if you can't talk, because it's all in his Word. So we're going to certainly pray for that, and you had your hand up as well, Marcelo.
I'd like to ask a prayer for a friend. Like I mentioned before, I was having this group of discussion on Facebook, and one of my friends, he started to guide, to direct himself to follow Torah, and he started to stop to eating unclean. And for my conversation with him, I think he's directing to start to keep Shabbat as well. But the big problem is that he don't find in our language. reference, so he's a little bit lost about what I'm going to do now. So I'm circumcised by people that think different than me, and I don't have a place to go. So he was mentioned to me, maybe you're going to start to have a congregation with Adventists, and because he say he's the closer that I can get. But so he's following very hard to what he needs to do now, with what direction he go, where he gonna have people around him that he can be together. So even like for people who speak English, even if you don't have a congregation near you, you have so many ministries online that you can be following. But he don't have that kind of opportunity. So I ask you to pray for him. His name is Manuel.
Manuel.
And Renny's asking me to ask prayer for his sister. Her name is Gloria, and she is in hospital today. They find out that she's dealing with a lot of infection in her body, lungs, and other parts of her body. I think the doctor doesn't know exactly what's causing the infection. So she's in hospital, and he's helping her. And he asked a prayer for Raquel as well, his daughter.
Yeah.
She was dealing with a very strong flu.
And there was, yeah.
Shabbat shalom,
everyone. Shabbat shalom.
I have three essays to complete. I've started them at uni for the 2nd of February. I just pray that you can pray for us, that you can pray for me. They are in process, but they're very, very tough. They're law, sexual work law essays. So I pray about that. And I'd also like to pray about the body, about the incoming Hebrews, and about divisions. I'd like to pray about divisions, and specifically racial divisions that a lot of preachers and a lot of believers are running away from. You can't keep running away from it. There's too many issues with black Hebrews and Celtic Hebrews and Ashkenazi Hebrews telling one another that we're not part of Israel, when it goes completely against what the Word has said. You know, you said it in your word today, Marcus, about God, you know, pouring out His Spirit. He pours out His Spirit on those who could call on Him. So I pray that with the ethnic groups within the Hebrew faith, that we recognize and apologize for one another's hurts and don't ignore what's going on, but that we also recognize one another as brethren, that there can be real reconciliation based on respect, not just ignoring things that have been done to one another. So it's especially in light of what's going on in America and around the world, but that's what I pray for the house, and I pray it can be a regular thing that we keep in our minds.
Okay. So saints, we're going to go and pray. So touch and agree. Pray in the name of Yeshua. There's pray for health in the body. Prayer for Manuel, that he can find a community of people for him to fellowship with, or for him to get the knowledge, for him to establish community with him and the Holy Spirit, or with whoever he can find. For Gloria and for Raquel, Gloria with infection, Raquel with flu, for the body as a whole, that we can come together, because that was Yeshua's prayer before he was glorified, that the body would be one as him and the Father is one, and then for wisdom and knowledge to pass Nicola in her examinations. So touch and agree, pray. As we say this prayer. Father in heaven, we come before you knowing that you are the healer. You said in your word in Exodus 15 that if we diligently hearken and observe all the things which you have commanded us, then you will remove sickness from your people. You'll remove disease from your people. All of the stuff which were upon Egypt will not be upon us, because you've set us apart. You've given us your word. You've given us your law, which will keep us a holy people, a set apart people, a royal priesthood. The nations should come to us as to how to be healed, how to be delivered, how to experience health and freedom in their minds and in their bodies like we have it. You said you'll place us above all other nations if we diligently hearken and observe your word. So in Yeshua's name, we bring before you the body of Messiah. We bring before you the assembly, Israel, today, knowing that there are many sick, there are many wounded, both physically and emotionally. And we bring this situation before you, asking that your presence, your spirit, which brings the healing, manifests across the body of Messiah, so that we will know that if we are to receive healing, that we need to get in tune with your word. Father, you tell us in the book of Psalms that you're sending your word to heal us. So I'm praying, Father, that you will give the body of Messiah, those in the Hebrew roots, messianic, and even the Christian world, an understanding that we need to get closer to your word. We need to get closer to following the footsteps of Yeshua if we are to receive our deliverance, our healing, our continual good health. We bring our bodies, our minds before you. And we speak into the situation concerning Martin. Father, you know how he has lived. And we recognize that there were times when you spoke and told people to get up from their sick bed, to rise up and walk. So we are praying in this situation that your name is glorified, that you'll raise him up from his bed, that you will establish that this is the day where in his life and in his family's life that you're glorified. We are praying even where he is, that you dispatch your angels to speak to him in that situation, to visit him and cause him to turn his life completely around. Father, we remember the in the book of Ezekiel, there were some dry bones. But you told your prophet to prophesy to the wind so that the dry bones would receive the breath of life so they can live. We ask that you breathe upon the whole household of Israel, in London, in Europe, in the United States, in Africa, in Asia, all over the world. So we can be that army of people, a kingdom of priests, servants to you. Father, we bring Manuel before you, and we bring Raquel before you. You know that the situations which we are facing, and we bring them into that prayer. We ask that you manifest your healing power in their lives, that you will transform them from being in a space of in pain, infection, sickness, to health. We rebuke the enemy from the life of the people inside of Renice and Maria's home. Amen. Father, We know that you have established a hedge of protection around your people. For when we look at Job, a faithful man, a righteous man, that the enemy could not come in. So we pray in proxy that your hedge of protection will be established around that home. And we, Father, we ask that it was Gloria, not Manuel, is it Gloria? Yeah, Gloria. That she be included in that prayer. That she is inside of the hedge of protection. That her pain is relieved in Yeshua's name. And I'm praying that the Spirit, which filled the disciples of old, will fill Renis and Maria. So they, Father, will have the boldness and courage to put oil on their hands and lay hands on these people themselves. Because we know that the prayers of the righteous man availeth much. And that Elijah, who commanded fire from heaven, who spoke and it rained and it stopped raining, he was a man just like us. So we bring Raquel and Gloria before you. We also know that in this place, we've all been in situations where we did not have fellowship. We did not have a place for us to go. We felt alone. But we know in the days of old, throughout history, you've always preserved the remnant. Even Elijah was in our situation where he felt he was the only one, but there were 7,000 who hadn't bowed the knee. We are praying, Father, in Yeshua's name, that you will connect Manuel with people who have not bowed the knee, who have placed in their heart the desire to set themselves apart for you, that he does not have to choose what might be considered the lesser of two evils, that he will be holy, sanctified, set apart, and in communion, in fellowship with like-minded people. Raise people up in his community, Father, in his town, in his city, that he can connect with. And we pray that same prayer over London, over Charlotte, over Lagos in Nigeria, over the Ukraine, over Russia and the nations of the earth. Pour out your Spirit on all flesh, Father. Cause the dry bones to receive flesh and the breath of life in them so we can be that army that you have prophesied will raise up. And Father, we are asking that all divisions amongst your people will be healed. That where there is different parts of your body, that different parts of your body will not fight amongst themselves. We know that the prayer of Yeshua, that his disciples will be one, as Yeshua and the Father are one. So help us to be one, Father. But also we ask that you help us to be one in truth. That we be not afraid to do righteous judgment, to speak truth in love, to bring correction to people sometimes, because we know that that correction will cause them to join us on the straight and narrow road. So help us with your Spirit so we can deal with the issues of the flesh which so corrupt the body. And finally, we pray for wisdom, knowledge, and a present help when Nicola goes through her examinations and submits her coursework. I'm praying in Yeshua's name that she will come out of this period of time a beacon for others. Present to her the opportunities, Father, to speak as to why she has so much peace, why she has so much confidence, why she is able to succeed and prevail in such a way. And I pray that prayer for all of the house of Israel, that we will be, although we are a peculiar people, but that we will be above all other people, set apart, a light unto the world. So when people are in darkness and they need somewhere to look, that their eyes don't focus on politicians, on celebrities, on drugs, on things which will further defile them, but on your spirit, on your righteousness. In Yeshua's name, we are thankful and grateful to be your remnant, your holy people. And we ask that you will once again blow upon us, breathe into us, impart your spirit within us. You've called us to be sent as you were sent. And we can't go in our own power and in our own authority. So I pray that as people may be asking for more of your spirit, that they will receive it. Help us in the areas of our lives where we need to make changes so we can get closer to you and receive more of you. In Yeshua's name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. You can come up. Eager to share your testimony. That's what I like to hear. Can you just release the... Hallelujah.
Shabbat shalom, everyone.
Shabbat shalom.
So many of you would remember last week I asked for prayer for my father, David, who was in a very difficult situation. He was bleeding from his stomach. And he was rushed to hospital, and we prayed a prayer that the Father has answered. Because where he was bleeding from is somewhere that is not accessible for any doctor to stop it. So the Father has stopped the bleeding. He had to stay in hospital for 5 days, but he's actually on his feet at home. So it is really to say thank God for answering to prayer, and pray he is now in a position to hear the Father speaking.
Hallelujah.
So pray that.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Father.
Hallelujah.
Glory. So I must say we were all shaken as a family. So we are a captive audience now for the Father. So we still need his wisdom.
Amen.
As there are still discussions on what needs to be done.
Amen.
And the main prayer is that the Father speaks to my father so that the management plan is what the Father directs. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And that... Was that a prayer we prayed after service, or was it during the additional prayer time?
No, you prayed during the service.
Hallelujah.
And you prayed, but though I didn't give you details, the prayer you prayed was directed by the Father, because you asked for the Father to stop bleeding in the stomach and to remove the growth in the stomach. That's where the growth is. And the word that I've shared with my father is, the Father has stopped the bleeding, and what he's now learning is to claim the promise that the mountain, which is that growth in the stomach, be removed and thrown into the sea.
Amen. We're going to pray for, Martin?
David.
Okay, let's pray for David. Father in heaven, we are so thankful.
Yeah.
That you are alive and you are healing people and you're delivering people and you're manifesting your power throughout the earth. And we again bring David before you, who is in a place where he's hearing and he's experiencing your power and your mercy and your grace in his own life. And we are praying and bringing him before you at this time, that you will continue the mighty work that you have begun in his life. that you will complete that work, not just for the healing in his body, but a restoration in his mind. We know that, Father, we can be set on a course from the time we are born to go in a certain direction which is created by a system. But we ask that he comes to a place where he understands that he needs to renew his mind. He needs to think again about Yeshua. He needs to think again about the Word and about the Torah and about things of the Spirit, so he can be a new creation. Father, I'm asking that you give all of the people around him wisdom and you give him them knowledge. So when they're speaking, they're not sowing bad seed into him, that they're sowing good seed into him so it can bear forth good fruit. I'm asking also that you give Juliet wisdom in this situation to speak your word, and that it will be received. Father, we are just again grateful and thank you, and pray that you will continue to manifest your glory in his life, in the family's life. Give them peace in Yeshua's name. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. So Father is a mighty Elohim. He continues to heal. He continues to deliver. He continues to do wonderful things around the earth. So please do continue to have faith in him. Have faith in the name of Yeshua. Nothing is impossible to those that believe. So don't ever think that your Elohim is unable to reach your wife, your husband, your children, your uncle. Just continue to press. And it looks like that is it. Unless I'm going to say the blessing over everyone, but unless there is anything else, then we are going to conclude. Okay. Receive your blessing. May YeHoVaH bless you and keep you. May YeHoVaH cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May YeHoVaH lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace in Yeshua's name. Amen. 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 Continue to hold the ministry in prayer. Pray for myself, my family, everyone that you see sitting in these chairs. Continue to hold them up in prayer. Every last Sabbath of the month, we're going to be spending some time in prayer. So come and join us. And I pray that you all have a wonderful time of rest and fellowship, and have a great week. Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom.